Let's talk about the cost of inverting a matrix. Now here we're going to assume that there's nothing special about the matrix. If the matrix has special structure or has a lot of zeros in it, then one might be able to do much better. So throughout we're going to assume that A is an n by n matrix. And recall that to compute the inverse of a matrix, what you do is you find a matrix such that A times that matrix is the identity. And what you can do is partition that matrix by columns and do the same thing with the identity matrix. And then you want to solve AX equals B with right-hand sides, the unit basis vectors, solving for each of the columns of the inverse of the matrix. Now here's a very naive approach. For each of the columns that you want to compute, that's why there's a for loop here, you factor the matrix A and then you do two triangular solves, much like you learned in the last 2 weeks. Performing the LU factorization cost approximately 2/3 n cubed floating point operations. And even if you add pivoting to it, roughly that is the cost. And then solving with the lower and upper triangular matrix costs n squared floating point operations per stage. So the total then for each column ends up being 2/3 n cubed plus 2 n squared floating point operations. But notice that we have to do that n times. So this has to be multiplied by n. And then you end up with a total cost of 2/3 n to the fourth plus 2 n cubed. And that's a lot of floating point operations. We're going to see that we can do a lot better than that. But keep this number in mind. Now, what do we notice? Well, we keep refactoring A. And that matrix A is always the same matrix. So what we really want to do is bring that outside the loop and do that exactly once. That gives us this loop right here. So now we factor once, and then we only do a lower and an upper triangular solve with each right-hand side, which starts as a unit basis vector. What's the cost then? Well, here we do perform 2n squared floating point operations per column. So we need to do that n times. And then we have to add to that the cost of factoring A once. So the total cost then becomes 2/3 n cubed plus 2 times n cubed, which if you work it out is 8/3 n cubed. So clearly we're doing much better because previously we were looking at 2/3 n to the fourth plus, what was it, 2 n cubed. But it turns out we can do slightly better yet. And let's have a look at that. So if you look at the one-sweep Gauss-Jordan inversion, then what do we have? Well, most of our computation is right here. Let's have a closer look at that. Okay, here are all the updates that happen. Now, these are just column vectors and row vectors with which you work, and we've seen in many other cases where we did a cost analysis, that's not where the computational expense is. The computational expense is in this update, which is a rank one update, this update, also a rank one update, and another rank one update, and another rank one update. Now notice that you march through matrix A and matrix B in the same way. So what we can do is we can say, well, the size of these two matrices is the same as the size of the matrices that were right there. So we can, in terms of analyzing how much cost there is, pretend that those matrices are all overlaid over the same matrix. And what you notice is that together, these four matrices cover essentially an entire n by n matrix. What are we doing for each element in that n by n matrix? Each of these rank one updates requires a multiply and an add for every element in the matrix that's being updated. So roughly speaking, every element in the entire matrix, except for a small piece that can be ignored, okay, one row and one column, for every element in an entire matrix, or the equivalent of an entire matrix, we're doing two floating point operations. How many of those elements are there? Well, approximately n squared, but that's in each iteration, so we have to do n iterations as we sweep through the matrix. And we notice that the total cost is now 2n cubed floating point operations. So we've brought it down from 8/3 n cubed floating point operations to 2/3 2n cubed floating point operations. So that's a savings of about 25% or so. And 25% is not nothing. So the bottom line is that the best algorithm that we have discussed for inverting a dense matrix that's n by n is 2n cubed floating point operations. And the interesting thing is that that's the same cost as performing a matrix-matrix multiply.